In life, we're trying to figure out how to be the best that we can be, produce the most results we can, and build relationships that last a lifetime. In your life, who are the most significant people in your life? Typically, it's a spouse or partner or significant other. Then literally it becomes your children. And then beyond that, it tends to be the people that you associate with in professional organizations, in golfing groups, or literally in some other type of interactive database that literally is working and striving to have real, live, authentic, transparent interactions, such as a church, synagogue, a mosque, or something literally derived around faith or philosophy, or some sort of educational lifestyle where you're a lifelong learner of sorts in some particular hobby or some particular professional outlook. You see, in life, we're looking for how do we protect ourselves from the harm in the world. Now, my perspective is that we're not training our children enough in rights of American citizenship. I literally feel that American citizenship should practically be a class every single morning, taught for a few minutes every single day, reminding children what their rights are, where they begin, and literally where they end. I apologize for the road noise. I'll try and shut the door to make it a little easier for people to hear me, but openly I'm hoping I've got a good enough sound barrier now that we can literally get to the heart of the message. Today we're talking about mass hazing. Now let me be openly clear about why I'm talking about this is not the point. That I want you to really understand what technology can do for you to not only get you the practical job and interactions that you need, but what can happen literally if you lose the rights to have technology. In my life, I've seen technology used well and technology used poorly. I've seen technology used greatly and technology used to harm people. You see, we are all believing that we're paying for this technology. And the technology that we're paying for is an invisible resource. Now, literally think about that. It sort of reminds me of the children's play and musical that one of my siblings wrote called King Midas and the Golden Touch. Now, the reality is that the Golden Touch is not the point. That he literally was walking around in invisible clothing by the time these lying tailors got finished with him. The lesson of the story is to teach children about lying and to teach children about modesty and literally to teach other people about not to put money as the highest, most important thing in the entire universe. But the reality is that whether or not you got that message as a child when you heard that story or whether or not you understand the ridiculousness of invisible clothing is sort of the reality of technology. We are literally paying for a technology that we can barely see. Now, isn't that an interesting infrastructure? With the telephone companies, we used to all have a telephone in our home with an actual phone line, which was a tangible thing that we literally could tell when the line was working and literally when the line was not. But now we are in the age of cyber communications, where that literally means that we're using satellites, we're using Bluetooth, we're using a lot of things like Wi-Fi to literally communicate. What we also know is that those data portals have a space, a little volume, an actual maximum capacity, which sort of really means that while we might all be paying the same price for our little service, it's very possible that the government or the technological companies are pocketing people in terms of their literal usage and allowing those who make a lot more phone calls or have a lot more power or a lot more money in the world to have more utilization or more fame and literally to be able to use those technologies a lot more than the average person. Now, does that seem like a conspiracy theory? No. Does it seem logical and rational? Absolutely. You see, all technology has an expense. There's literally people who have to monitor that technology. There's people who have to service the technology when it goes down. And there's people who have to work on payroll of paying all those people. So there's always a capital expense in terms of a physical building for these technology holding structures. But at the same time, there's human resources that are required in order to have our technology. So in actual truth, a phone line might really only cost $5. But we're literally paying $65 to $100 on top of that for all the people involved in providing us that technology. Now, does that make sense? Sure it does. Because your salary is based on the efforts of not only yourself, usually, but other people. In the entrepreneurial world, our salaries are based wholly solely based on the number of clients we serve and how long we can keep them as our prospective clients. In my little work in my Kanji Camp Japanese language program, where I teach how to master the Japanese language in a prolific sort of way, I literally had clients who stayed with me for 4 to 7 years. Now, openly, I don't have those databases anymore because I let them go to protect the clients. I allowed them to be shredded by a sibling who was responsible for making sure that those privately held documents of people's phone numbers, addresses, and their educational programming was shredded. If she literally did not do that, then she violated my request of her to protect the rights of the people who were paying me a salary, literally. Now, the salary came about from the work I did in literally educating them. In your life, you've got people in your life that need a salary. You have people who are looking for jobs. You have people who are sold a bill of goods about getting a bridge job, and they literally get stuck in it so that they're working into their 70s and 80s long after they should have stopped working. Now, it's true that some men are incredibly bored, and so they want to go do some work, so they have a little cash for their little hobbies or their travel plans, and they really do have a retirement, and they don't want to dip into that retirement account because they saved a long time, so they do work and they do have those hustle jobs. But there's another handful of people, a large subset of the population, that is literally concerned about what will happen to them in their old age. They're literally worried about how will they handle the responsibilities of not only growing old gracefully in terms of their cellular health, but they are practically also interested in knowing how are they going to pay for their life in a society that puts a heavy barrier in the lives of people with regard to technology. You see, cell phones for the elderly don't really exist. Do we have cell phones that have large buttons and large numbers, large enough for the elderly eyes to see? No. I'm literally approaching 50, and I always have to put my glasses on just to see my own technology most of the time. That's because my eyesight has sort of failed in the last 2 years, but I believe that came about from stress and other causes in my life. I still take an eye product when I'm allowed, and openly that stuff is somewhere, literally, in my mother's home, and I'm not allowed to go get it, apparently. And that's a problem, that we have people that take away our rights without talking to us ever. Now, who has the little right to do that? You see, when we're not on track in life, we openly get hit by the lack of technology. In my life, I've simply thrown my phones away is not true, that what I realized was that my phones were being literally used to follow where I was going in life. They were literally being used to tell someone information about me, which was not that person's right to share. And literally, someone has stolen all the business cards that I've received in my journeys. Now, who has the lawful right to put their hands in someone's pockets, in their little carry bags that like a motorcycle man has, and openly take out a person's contact information? You see, we live in a society where people pilfer. They literally think they have some right to take things away from other people. That is not the truth. We really have to look at technology and how it is utilized around us. Are you getting all the phone calls you're supposed to be getting for your business practice? Are you getting all the opportunities to solicit friendships through people that you meet as you're interacting socially? Or is someone isolating you from those opportunities because the technology doesn't work like it's supposed to or like we're sold it does? You see, I'm not crapping on any telephone company in principle. I'm only just saying that we have no way to measure whether or not we're getting real service in these invisible technologies. We literally need more places where people can go on a regular basis, not only plug in their phones and their computers to literally do their work, but we need places and social networks where we can go, and it's sort of a standard that it's okay to talk to other people in that establishment. Yes, there will still be predators trying to hit on people, trying to rape girls, trying to do all the horrible things that man has come to being because they've gotten so far away from loving other people. And yes, we do have people who are ill-willed out there. But in general, the people who are there for the right reasons will help to protect, honor, and celebrate the skills, the minds, the talents of the people who attend those places looking for more opportunities in life. You see, the later it gets in life, the harder it is to find that new opportunity. And if you think I'm being morose, go live my life a little while. You see, someone keeps hitting a kill switch on my vehicle. My vehicle is paid for in full now twice, unfortunately, because the people in northern Indiana not only sold me a lemon, but then the man who took the money to repair it back to like new didn't exactly do his job right either. Each mechanic that I literally go to is telling me something new about my car, and I'm like, really? The other guy said this was the problem. I think we need a little more regulation in that industry to protect our lawful rights to our legal property. You see, that's where the situation begins and ends. We all purchase cell phones. We either buy them outright, like I do, or someone literally sells it to us little by little over time to save our money on an overpriced technology unit from Japan. In my life, I've seen this occur, that someone else thinks they have the proper right to put applications on our phone is really an issue. Who gave that company the right to put that stuff on our phone? The company who's selling the telephone. But do we want them applications eating up our battery, eating up our space online, and providing them copies of our contact list? Not really. So we have to get back to the rights of the individual to have a telephone, to have contact lists, to have business cards, to practically have a technology that is a proven source, resource, if you will, for a person's life, for their professional world, and for their personal interactions. Now, this has been Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications, LLC. I'm rendering opinions in these audio files. I haven't done a podcast in a while because I'm looking for the right interviews. I've got some interviews that I'm writing up at the moment from some conversations I've had with some people who are dealing with some special circumstances. But one question that I really want to pose to us is, what do we do with those complaints that we receive from other people about our companies? Do we draw the line and say, no, our people would never do such a thing? Or would we practically go, you know, human beings are still human. They make mistakes, they put us in legal jeopardy, and they sometimes take other people's rights away without thinking or doing it intentionally. So we have to look at how we handle complaints, and I'll talk about handling complaints from a marketing perspective in the next audiocast. Thanks for taking the time to listen this morning. I hope you found this a little bit intriguing in terms of the idea of invisible technology that we're purchasing and literally paying for. And how do we measure whether or not we're getting our full value from what we've got? In time, I hope you will understand